So next section is related party transactions, section number 188. Structure of section 188. 188 is divided into following parts. 188 subsection number 1. 1 la A, B, C, D, E, F, G. These are the points. Proviso 1, Proviso 2, Proviso 3, Proviso 4, Proviso 5. Okay, along with that explanation A, explanation B, and explanation A again, sub explanation number 1 and 2. 186 subsection 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 again 1 and 2. These are the various points. Very big section. Along with this, we need to read related party definition under section 2 class 76. Having again another 9 points inside. Very, very big section in our syllabus. Okay. In this board meetings and board powers topic, na, biggest section is related party transactions. We need to read this along with section number 177, subsection number 4, class number 4, read with rule number 6A, audit committee omnibus approval. Very big area. 188 subsection number 1, class number A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Proviso 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Explanation A, sub explanation 1, sub explanation number 2. Explanation number B. 188 2, 188 3, 188 4, 188 5. Again, subsection clause number 1 and clause number 2. Along with that, we need to read with section number 2, class 76, related party definition. Along with that, we need to cover 177, subsection number 4, clause number 4. Read with rule number 6A, audit committee omnibus approval. Once all these are completed, then we can tell that related party section is completed to its entirety. Clear everyone? Shall we start with the concept? So let's make a move. First one, charging of the section. When section gets attracted, first, there are four cases. Related party, there are seven kinds of related parties are there. Okay, seven kinds of related parties. What do you mean by seven kinds of related parties? Director or his relative, KMP or his relative, a firm in director or his relative, KMP or his relative, a firm in which director or manager or his relative is a partner, a private company in which director or manager or his relative is a director or a member, a public company in which director or manager is a director and holds along with his relative not less than or more than 2% of the total paid up share capital. Okay, and next one will be a body corporate whose board of directors, managing director, manager whereof is accustomed to act in accordance with the advice, directions or instructions of the director or manager. Any person upon whose advice, directions or instructions director or manager is accustomed to act. Any company which is a company's holding company, subsidiary company, associate company or subsidiary of a holding company to which it is also a subsidiary. This is all the definition of a related party covered by section 2 class 76. There will be seven kinds of parties governed: individuals, firms, private company, public company, body corporate, person, group company. Seven transactions will be there. How many? Seven. So all the seven. That means related parties, there are seven kinds of related party. There are seven specified transactions. Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or material, selling or otherwise disposing of or buying property of any kind, leasing of property of any kind, availing or rendering any services, appointment of any agent for purchase or sale of the goods, services, property. And next one is such related parties appointment to any office or place of profit in the holding company or subsidiary subsidiary company or associate company, and underwriting the subscription of any securities or derivatives of a body corporate. These are all governed by the section. So seven transactions are there. So there are seven related party types, seven different transactions to attract 188. Case 1, transaction is with any one of the seven related parties. One among the seven transactions, 188 attracted. Case 2, transaction is not with related parties but one among the transaction, not attracted because it is not with a related party, na. So transaction is one among the related party with the one among the related party but it's not the specified transaction, section don't get attracted. Fourth case, not attracted at all. Am I clear? So this is the first one, charging of the section. Okay, transactions with whom? Transaction with the related party as defined under section 2 class 76. First, individuals la, director, relatives, KMP, relatives completed, individual. Firm, which kind of firm? A firm in which director, manager or his relative is a partner. Okay, private company, private company in which director, manager or relative is a director or a member. Public company, very important, director or manager is a director. First, our company director or our company manager is a director in this public company. Not just directorship is important. Holds along with his relative more than 2% of the shareholding or paid up share capital. Sir, hold along with his relative. Relatives tho patuga. He or his relatives illa. First, he should have at least one share. Then only you need to take the relatives count. If he is not holding even a single share, then how it will become along with his relatives? Along with him, first he should be there. If he is not a shareholder, you need not take the relatives shareholding strength. Okay, so tell me, A private company in which director, manager or relative is a director or a member. Public company in which director or manager, relative is not governed, is a director first and holds along with his relative more than 2% of the shareholding, paid-up share capital. Same, accustomed tax. A body corporate is there. Board of directors, managing director, manager, whereof is accustomed tax in accordance with the advice, directions or instruction of our company's director or manager. Okay, I will come from the beginning once again. See here. Individual, firm, private company, public company, body corporate, person, group company. Seven. Okay, that's why I written related parties are seven transactions, seven parts are there. Related party definition. Okay, individual, director relative, KMP relative. Firm, director, manager, relative is a partner. Not every KMP, only manager is governed in the KMP. Okay, a private company in which director, manager, relative is a director or a member. A public company in which director or manager is a director and holds along with the relative more than 2%. Body corporate accustomed to act. Now, see here, I will explain one important point. Our company is having a director or a manager. Let's say director. This director gives advice or directions or instructions. Okay. According to our company's director or manager's instructions, there is a body corporate. That body corporate's board or MD or manager is accustomed to act. That means our directors are influencers. This body corporate is influenced. Okay. According to our directions. This is a reverse. There is a person. That person give advice as our director or manager is accustomed to act. That means that person is influencer, our director or manager is influenced, indirectly our company is controlled with this person is also a related party. Group companies, our company, holding company is a related party, subsidiary is a related party, associates are related party, subsidiary to our holding company is a related party. Clear? Just, I will give you a minute time, not even that, half a minute time, if you want you can look into the definition clearly. So next part, which transactions are covered? 188 subsection number 1, read with explanation number A1 and A2. What is explanation A1 and A2? We will read later. First, let us understand what are the transactions that are specified. 188, 182, 188, 1G. See here. Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or materials. Okay. Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or no explanations like in a normal session. Please try to understand. So we are going by a quick revision. Already you know why these points came. So, no sort of any explanation and lawmaker's intention behind that. Okay, all these are governed in the normal sessions. So, here I just want to tell what are the transactions that are governed with a small piece of explanation. Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or material, trading P&L item is governed. Selling or otherwise disposing of or buying property of any kind, balance sheet is governed. Leasing of property of any kind, P&L and balance sheet is governed, but recently amended, amendment is provided. What is that amendment? I will tell you later. Point is not amended. Previously, there is a link even with the balance sheet item, but now it was deleted. Why? I will tell you when we come to the ceiling limits under related party transaction. But remember the transaction now. Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or materials. Selling or otherwise disposing of or buying property of any kind. Okay. Here, goods or materials purchase sale. Here, properties purchase and sale. Okay. P&L items, balance sheet items. This is P&L item, leasing rents. Okay. Lease rent will be paid or lease rent will be received. Leasing means it can be either lessee or lessor. Next, D, availing or rendering of any services, either service provider or service recipient, trading P&L, appointment of agent to carry on 1, 2 and 4, A, B and D. See, in a leasing, lease does not have any agency. That means if these transactions are not directly entered by the company with the related party, but entered with the agent who will indirectly sell that to our company's related party, section gets attracted. That means I will explain in this way. If company directly makes a transaction with related party, section gets attracted.
therefore company will appoint a sole selling agent. Sole selling agent, they will appoint agent. Okay, that means the company intentionally appoint one person. That person is a non-related person. Company will sell to him, he will sell to director. Anyway, transaction is made to director or not, if that be the case, sir, director purchases from Big Bazaar, sir. Okay, let's say for example, see here, for that only I made this example. Okay, transactions through an agent, how to understand? Hindustan Unilever is there, in that Mr. A is a director. Okay, from Hindustan Unilever, this director purchased goods from HUL. Section 188 attracted? Yes, attracted. Okay, directly from HUL you need to purchase. Bulk of goods they will purchase, not attracted. HUL is there. In that Mr. A is a director. A went to Big Bazaar and purchased goods from HUL. Section attracted? He is an agent. Section attracted or not? No, because this agent is not appointed agent. This is a normal agency contract. That's all. That means he is not an agent between A and HUL. He is agent for everyone. Am I clear? He is agent for everyone. That means HUL will sell the goods through Big Bazaar. Will sell goods through Big Bazaar. Big Bazaar is not appointed by HUL. Big Bazaar is one of the mediation between HUL and Mr. A, Mr. B, or Mr. C, or entire universe. Am I clear? He is, Big Bazaar is an agent in the middle, but it's not appointed agent. That's why section uses the word appointment of an agent. Okay. Not attracted because this is not the agent governed by related party transaction. Related party transaction is the word appointed agent, but this is not appointed agent. No? Next, HUL is there, Mr. A is a director. Mr. A went to HUL. Okay, sole selling agent is there. There is an agreement between A and HUL. Agreement is we will be putting a sole selling agent in the middle. HUL will sell to him, he will sell to you. In that case, section gets attracted. So, therefore, the first one is appointment of agent is most important. Am I clear? So, appointment of agent. Next, such a related party's appointment to any office or place of profit in the company, subsidiary company, associate company. This one I will separately explain now. Just 5 to 10 minutes it will take to complete all these things. But still, I will keep this point on hold because it requires good explanation as well. So, first one, sale, purchase or supply of any goods or material, selling or otherwise disposing of or buying property of any kind, leasing a property of any kind, availing or rendering of any services. A, B, D through agent and office or place of profit. Lastly, underwriting. That means if the company pays underwriting commission to any of the related parties, section will get attracted. Okay. Now, analysis. 188 1A covers both cash and credit transaction. That's why you choose the word supply. Supply is not under section 7 of GST. This is another different. Property, use the word mobile, immobile, tangible, intangible, India or outside India. Most important is whether it is owned by company or not. Substance over the form. Leasing, company can be lesser, company can be lessee. Less lease includes the sublease as well. Services, company can be service recipient or service provider. Okay, agency is also governed. Transaction 6, very very important, officer place of profit. Listen carefully to the concept. Sir, what is this officer place of profit? There is a company, in this company Mr. A is a director or a managing director of this particular company, very big listed company. Mr. A is having 3 great achievements in life. Okay, son 1, son 2, daughter, 3 great achievements. Son 1, 6th fail, son 2, 10th fail, daughter, CBT fail. All are very good graduated fellows. These people are empty. They don't have any kind of employment. Okay, they are jobless in the home. He was very, very sad. He want to do something. He want to make them as directors in the company. He want to make them as a directors in the company. Company is a achapudisu kortundi. Reason enti? Because if you want to become director, okay, if you want to become director, you need to pass through the shareholders' approval. So, Companies Act will not allow you, because director, if you want to get appointed, you need to get the sanction of the shareholders under 160. Which fool shareholder will allow these people to come after seeing their great qualifications? So, therefore, you don't want to bring them. And moreover, why he want to make them as employees in the company? Why he want to bring them into the company? To give some remuneration to them. Okay, you give some remuneration. Remuneration of directors is governed by section number 197. Therefore, even he don't want to bring them as directors, he want to bring them in the form of employees, because employees remuneration is not governed by Companies Act. Is not governed by Companies Act. For example, you qualified chartered accountancy, you went into internal audit job in Infosys. Your appointment will be made by Narayan Murthy. He will come and make you an appointment. Normal HR department will make you as a internal auditor. Am I clear? That means your remuneration is not governed by Companies Act. Your remuneration is governed by internal policy making of the company. that I can manage as a managing director, I want to bring them as a employees in the company. Those type of transactions are governed by 188 subsection number 1, class number F, explanation number A1 and A2. Okay, this is all I can explain only in the normal session, because it will take time if I have to explain all this. Okay, so let's go to OPP and stick on to that and explain. Explanation A. See here, what is an OPP? What is officer place of profit? What is the meaning? Okay, for a director, what is an OPP? Sir, in capacity as a director, I will receive remuneration or not? Yes. Other than as a director, in that company or in the subsidiary company or in the associate company. Okay, in that company or subsidiary company or associate company, I am already a director. In capacity as a director, I am receiving some remuneration? Yes. I am taking second office with the influence of my directorship. I am taking second office. I am a chartered accountant. Okay, I become director in a company. You can become. You can't become a director in a company where you are a statutory auditor. Okay, I am a chartered accountant. I become a director in a company. But I am a chartered accountant means I have a good finance logic or not. I want to become finance manager in the same company. How you got finance manager? Obviously, I am a director. With influence, I got that. That means OPP will get attracted for a director. If he is a director, along with this director's office, he is taking second office. For that second office, he is taking some remuneration. It's a OPP. Because in capacity as a director, already you will receive remuneration under 197. Now, with the influence of this directorship, you will be taking a second office. Yes. For the second office, there is remuneration. That means this remuneration is included into director remuneration. This remuneration is over and above your director remuneration. This remuneration is over and above. Over and above. That's what the section uses the word. Director holding it receives from company anything by way of remuneration over and above the remuneration for which he is entitled as a director. That means he is entitled as a director for 197 section. 5%, 10% remuneration. In excess of that, if you take any remuneration for another office, that office will be OPP. That office will be OPP. Sir, I am a director, sir. 197, I can take 5%, sir. I am taking 7%, sir. OPP, not an OPP, because there is no second office in that case. There is no second office in that case. That means what you need to understand, if you take excess remuneration under 197, that excess remuneration has to be kept in the trust of the company and it should be refunded within 2 years or a time specified by the board of directors as per section number 197. Okay. Therefore, director capacity like excess remuneration you will draw, that is governed by 197, not by officer place of profit 188 1F. 188 1F will get attracted only if you are a director in that company. Second office is accepted either in that company or in the subsidiary company or in the associate company, holding company not governed by 188 1F. You can see the Bayer Act. Okay, for that you need to take remuneration. Am I clear? That means I am a director, I am not taking second office. Okay, I am taking excess remuneration governed by 185 187, not by 188. I am a director taking second office, but free of cost I am doing OPP will not get attracted. That means to get attracted by OPP, first you need to be a director, accept second office. For that you need to take some remuneration. OPP will get slightly attracted. Sir, only director governed, related party is also same, but related party he is not a director already. Therefore, any remuneration you take for the office you take, no second. So second office will come if you are already a director. Related party is not a director in the company. Any office taking some remuneration, OPP gets attracted. Clear everyone? So this is all. So these are all illustrations which we will generally do in the class, because time boundary is there to complete revision. So therefore, now various approvals required. First we covered transaction with whom, which transactions are governed. Now we are going into various approvals that are required. Okay. What are the approvals that are required? Three kinds of approvals: board approval, shareholder approval, audit committee approval. Board approval, 188 subsection number 1. 188 subsection number 1. Okay. See here. Board approval, irrespective of amount involved. 1 rupee related party, board approval. Prior approval, board meeting level, no RBC, simple majority, not like the previous one, unanimous consent, simple majority. Okay. Next. Audit committee approval is also required. Okay. This is the need for audit committee approval. I just don't want to waste the time here. Audit committee approval is generally required in all the cases. However, a problem has come. Audit committee, there will be audit committee. Okay. Audit committee, all related party transactions irrespective of amount involved require board and audit committee approval. But there is a problem. In audit committee approval, auditors will not be there. In audit committee, directors will be there. In board, directors will be there. Anyway, you are taking board or audit committee means board members are there, na? There may be duplication. There may be duplication. Okay. Therefore, there is an option to exempt audit committee approval through omnibus approval. Omnibus means one-time approval. Every time you need not come to audit committee, I will give one-time approval. And that's not mandatory. That's only optional. Okay. Criteria for omnibus approval. For example, there is a transaction to be taken through omnibus, na? What are the conditions that audit committee will place? Maximum value of transactions in aggregate. That means 7 transactions are there totally. How much is allowed through omnibus route? Totally, all the transactions put together. They may tell like this. 50 crores for one financial year. For all 7 transactions, if they tell, na, till that 50 crores is not crossed, you need not again come to audit committee. Internally, sublimits also they can tell. They can tell first transaction sale purchase. If it crosses 5 crores, you need to come to audit committee again. So omnibus is valid totally for 50 crores. Internally, for the sublimit of first transaction, it is only 5 crores. Okay. What disclosures they need to make while sanctioning? Board has to disclose something, na? What disclosures? And I have given omnibus approval only for 50 crores. Internally, for 5 crores for each transaction. Let's say like that. Am I clear? Even after 5 crores is crossed, they are not coming to audit committee. In that case, I need to review, na? So review at such intervals. Okay, audit committee can also tell which transactions for which they can't give omnibus. Okay, validity period. Audit committee omnibus approval is valid only for a period of not exceeding 1 year and required to renew upon expiry, one financial year. No omnibus approval cases. In these cases, you can't give omnibus approval. Transaction with regard to selling and disposing of property and undertaking. That means section number 180, subsection number 1, class number A is there, na? Sale, purchase or supply of any goods are, sorry. To sell, lease or otherwise dispose of whole or substantially whole of undertaking. That transaction, if it is with a related party, you can't take it through omnibus. Even though the value is lesser than 5 crores or 2 crores or whatever the value may be, you need to take them only directly to the audit committee. Transactions as may be decided by audit. Along with this, this is mandatory. Along with this, they can also add some transactions which cannot be subjected to omnibus route. While preparing omnibus approval, what factors are to be considered? Sir, omnibus means what? You are exempting from every time approval. When you need to exempt, if the transaction is repetitive in nature. How do you know that it is repetitive? In the past, we have a trend. Or in the future, already agreement entered, there is a continuous supply of service for next 2 years. Every month, minimum 2-3 times, they will provide service. Every time, how can we take audit committee approval? So therefore, justification, why you are coming? Okay. Unforeseen related party transaction. Past la, there is no repetition. In future also we don't have any repetition. That means we don't have any solid proof that it will repeat in future. In that case, they can give only transaction value not exceeding 1 crore. If it exceeds 1 crore, come to the omnibus. Come to the audit committee approval. That means they can tell like this. Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or material to any director up to 1 crore, no audit committee approval. How do you know? Whether with the director we will enter or not, we don't know, unforeseen. But give up to 1 crore, up to 1 crore, we will not come to audit committee approval again. But if it crosses 1 crore per transaction, yes, we will come. So, omnibus approval, simply listen and remember one thing. Omnibus approval is required if the transaction is repetitive in nature. Anyway, board is approving. Audit committee is also having directors. Why duplication has of approvals is required? Okay, that's the idea. Shareholders approval. Shareholders approval, first proviso to section 188.1, right with rule number 15.3. Amended provision applicable for November 2020 examination for the first time. Very important, listen carefully. Transactions and ceiling limits. Okay. Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or material. Transaction number 1. Along with the agents, if it exceeds up to 10% or more of the turnover of the previous financial year. Previously, R rupees 100 crores, whichever is lower, like that it will be returned. Everything is deleted now. 10%, this is P&L item na, turnover linked. 10% or more of the turnover of preceding financial year. Selling and otherwise disposing of property na, 10% or more of the net worth of the preceding financial year. Leasing a property of any kind, 10% or more of turnover. Previously, turnover or net worth used to be given, now that was deleted. First, transaction number 1, P&L item, 10% of turnover. Balance sheet, 10% of net worth. Lease rental, 10% of turnover, P&L item. Services, P&L item, 10% of turnover. These transactions are already included with the agents. Na? So, agents separately, no ceiling limit given. OPP employment remuneration is there. Na? If it is up to 2 lakh 50, only board approval is required. If it crosses 2 lakh 50 per month, to shareholders approval is also required. In all cases, remember ordinary resolution. 186 la special, here ordinary. Underwriting commission up to 1% of net worth, no problem. If it crosses the underwriting commission, crosses that amount, yes, permission required. Disclosures required. Disclosures required. What to where to disclose? Board report. Okay. What to be disclosed? Details of contractor arrangement entered along with justification. Why you entered only with related party when there are so many parties in the immediate proximity of the company? Why you entered only with related? What sort of benefit the company is getting? Please justify the related party transaction. Format is AOC 2. Next, part number 5. Consequence of contraventions are marked very, very important for the exam. See here. Effect on the contract. Sir, simply in related party transaction, 3 approvals are required. Board approval, shareholders approval, audit committee approval. In that audit committee leave off, because audit committee is governed by 177, not by 188. In 188 section, typically we require 2 approvals, board, shareholders. As per 177 read with 188, audit committee. Audit committee approval really not governed by 188 section, it is governed by 177. But I interlinked both of them for easy understanding. Okay. Now, effect on the contract. If I don't take board approval, if I don't take shareholders approval, or when required, if I don't take both, then only contravention will get attracted. That's so sometimes related party transactions will get attracted, but a situation may arise where board can't pass a resolution immediately. Do you know why? Company is entering into contract with a related party. Okay. Related party transaction should come to board meeting level. RBC not possible. Take it off. Okay. Even I can't conduct a video conferencing because it is very costly. Technically, it is very costly. I can't even afford that now. Because for video conferencing, I need to spend around 2 to 3 lakhs. Company is entering into a related party transaction. I agree. Value is only 25,000. Value is only 25,000. Are video conferencing will cost me 1.5 lakh or 2 lakhs. Okay. 1.5 lakhs or 2 lakhs it will be taking for me. The contract value is 25,000. Why I require approval to be taken? So therefore, prior board approval not obtained. Prior shareholders approval not obtained. Sometimes it may not be taken because of the value is very limited. Both not obtained. Both not obtained. If not obtained, no issue, sir. No contravention. At least ratify them within 3 months. Put for ratification. If the company don't even put it for ratification, then that contract becomes voidable. Answer everyone. Prior board approval not obtained. Prior shareholders approval not obtained. Or sometimes both not obtained. At least ratify within 3 months. If you don't even ratify within 3 months, then only contract becomes voidable. If you put it for ratification, contract is voidable. It may either become valid or void. If you don't put for ratification, it continues to be voidable. That means deemed validity will not be given. That's the idea. Am I clear? And because of not taking the approval of the board, because of not taking the shareholders' approval, a related party transaction is entered. Because of that, company incurred a loss. It will be recorded from the directors and the employees. Sir, which employee, sir? Employee means key employee, KMPs. Okay. And listed company and unlisted company penalties are provided. That you need to read. Okay. Refer penalty chart. Effect on the directors. So, 3 effects are there. Third effect, you have to remember the penalty amounts. But here I will explain. I will explain once again. Listen. Effect on the contract. Prior board approval not obtained. Shareholders approval not obtained. Both not obtained. At least ratify within 3 months. Or else transaction continues to be voidable. It will not get deemed validity. And loss caused, you know, you can recover from the directors. Okay. Exemptions. What is that? Exemptions. What is exemption? See here. Transactions entered at arm's length price. Fourth proviso to section 188.1. Related party transactions entered in the ordinary course of business at an arm's length price. 188.1 not obtained. 188.1 is only exempted. Board report la disclosure is required even for arm's length transactions, related party transactions being arm's length. 188.1 is only exempted. No exemption from audit committee approval. No exemption from 188.2, 3, 4, 5. Only 188.1. 188.1 contains what? Shareholders approval and board approval. Those 2 approvals are not required. Disclosures, contraventions, everything will get attracted. Am I clear or not? Okay, related party transaction entered in the ordinary course of business at arm's length price. 188.1 not applicable. Okay, now exemptions and non-applicability. So here exemptions and non-applicability. Na filing no filing exemptions and non-applicability. Second proviso, third proviso, fourth, fifth. In that fourth proviso, we completed arm's length. Okay, now let us come to second, third and fifth proviso. What this fifth proviso tell? Notes is not there from here, I will tell. Holding company and wholly owned subsidiary related party transactions, section 188, 1 is not applicable. Okay, with whom? Holding company, wholly owned subsidiary, mutual transactions, holding company selling to wholly owned selling to holding company, and whatever the case may be, section gets attracted. So section will not get attracted. Approvals not required. Am I clear or not? Okay. In this case, you need to observe one very important point. Holding company, wholly owned subsidiary, both are related parties. Both are related parties. Okay. Holding company selling to wholly owned subsidiary some goods. Okay. It is a related party transaction for both, but exempted. But exempted. Okay. Now, listen carefully to one important point here. Holding company entering into related party transaction with wholly owned subsidiary. If it exceeds the ceiling limit, if it exceeds the ceiling limit, shareholder's approval is also exempted or not? Okay. Exempted for whom? Holding company or wholly owned? Don't tell for both, because ceiling limit depends on my turnover. Okay, wholly owned subsidiary's turnover like 10% may not cross, but it may cross 10% turnover of wholly owned subsidiary, holding company. So vice versa also can happen. Therefore, to take shareholders approval, let's take like this. There is a company called as X Limited and Y Limited. Both are not holding wholly owned, normal companies. X Limited and Y Limited are there. Okay, both are related parties, let's say. Okay, sir, listen, this is very important. At the last time telling you, X Limited and Y Limited are there. The X Limited the director is a director and holding 3% paid up share capital in this company. Okay, now X Limited and Y Limited, X Limited la there is a director, Mr. X. He is also a director here and holding 3% paid up share capital. Now X Limited and Y Limited are both are related parties or not? That means for X Limited, Y Limited is a related party. For Y Limited, X Limited is a related party. Yes or no? No, a big blatant no. This is where you can commit wrong in exam. X Limited ke Y Limited related gaani, Y Limited ke X Limited related party kaadu. That means for X Limited, Y Limited is a related party. Why? Because my director is a director and holding 3%. But for Y Limited, how X Limited will become related party? None of my director is a director and holding 3%. Therefore, compliance of this section is required to be made only by X and not by Y Limited. Very, very important for the exams. No question has asked like this in the examination till now. But if asked, you should be writing properly. Am I clear? That means for Y Limited, X Limited is not a related party. Then why board, Y Limited will pass a board resolution? It is a related party transaction to X Limited, not to Y. Clear or not? If both are related parties and ceiling limit exceeded, you need to check ceiling limit exceeded for whom? Because ceiling limit is dependent on my previous year's turnover. Am I clear? My turnover and X Limited and Y Limited turnover both is same, to have a same ceiling limit. Very careful. Okay. So, sir, second and third proviso, in simple sense I will tell. Second proviso tells that in the general meeting, ceiling limit exceeded. General meeting started. In the general meeting, related parties are sitting. Those related parties can't vote. Like quorum concept is neither interested directors. This is like interested members cannot vote. But if 90% or more of the members sitting in the meeting are interested, then this provision does not apply. That's what third proviso says. Okay. This is all about section number 188, related party transactions. In a nutshell, I will complete very fast. Listen, without touching audit committee omnibus approval route. Okay. That will again take some time. So first one, transactions with whom? Transaction with a related party. Okay, transaction with a related party. Who is a related party? Director or is related to KMP or is related to a firm in which director or manager or relative is a partner, a private company in which director or manager or relative is a director or a member, a public company in which director or manager is a director and holds along with is related to more than 2% of the paid up share capital of the company, or any body corporate whose board of directors, managing director, manager, where office accustomed to act in accordance with the directions or instructions of the director or manager, any person upon whose advice, directions or instruction director or manager accustomed to act in group companies, being holding company, subsidiary company, associate company or subsidiary of holding company to which it is also a subsidiary. Which transactions are covered? Sale, purchase or supply of any goods or materials, selling and otherwise disposing of or buying property of any kind, leasing a property of any kind, availing or rendering of any services, or appointment of an agent to transact with the purchase, sale or goods or services or property. Next one is such a related party's appointment in the office or place of profit either in the company or subsidiary company or associate company or underwriting of the subscription of any securities or derivatives thereof. Okay, various these are the transactions with whom. which transactions are governed. Various approvals required irrespective of amount involved, board approval, parent approval, board meeting level, no resolution by circulation, and simple majority approval is very much required to be taken. After that, the next approval is shareholders approval. Ceiling limits are given. If the ceiling limits are exceeded, shareholders approval is also required. Ordinary resolution. Disclosures required. Board report, like AOC2, like you need to report about the related party transaction along with the justification why you are entering into such related party transactions. And after that, disclosures, consequence of contraventions, prior board approval not taken, prior shareholders approval not taken, both not taken, at least ratify within 3 months. If you don't ratify, the transaction continues to be voidable at the option of the board or shareholders as the case may be, whose approval you didn't take. And after that, if there is any loss, recovery of loss from the directors, penalties you need to read from 188 subsection number 5. Along with this, I forgot to tell, disqualifications under 188 subsection number 1, class number H will also get attracted. Disqualified for 5 years, okay? Vacation will get attracted simultaneously. Next issue. After that, filing and requirements, no filing is there. And exemptions and non-applicability, I already said, arm's length prices, ordinary course of business, related party transactions, exempted from 188 subsection number 1. So these are all the various issues that I want to cover in related party transaction. Thank you.